When shall we three meet again? In thunder, lightning, or in rain?
When the hurly-burly's done, when the battle's lost and won,
back will be ere the set of sun. Where to place
upon the heath,
where to meet with Macbeth. Fair is foul, and foul is fair.
Hover through the fog.
Hover through the fog and filthy air.
What bloody man is that? He can report that seemeth by his plight to revolt the new estate.
This is the sergeant who, like a good and hardy soldier, fought against my captivity. Hail, brave friend! Say to the king the knowledge of the broil as thou didst leave it.
Doubtful it stood, as two spent swimmers that do cling together choke their art. The merciless MacDonald and fortune on his damned quarrel smiling showed like a rebel's whore. But all's too weak. For brave Macbeth, well he deserves that name, disdaining fortune with his brandished steel, which smoked with bloody execution, like valor's minion, carved out his passage till he faced a slave, which ne'er shook hands nor bade farewell to him till he unseamed him from the nave to the chops and fixed his head upon our back.
Valiant cousin, worthy gentleman!
As once the sun gins his reflection, shipwracking storms and direful thunders break, so from that spring whence comfort seemed to come, discomfort swells. Mark, King of Scotland, mark! No sooner justice had with valor armed, but the Norwegian lord, surveying vantage with furbished arms and new supplies of men, began a fresh assault.
Dismayed not this, our captains Macbeth and Banquo?
Oh, yes. As sparrows, eagles, or the hare, the lion. If I say sooth, I must report, they were as cannons overcharged with double cracks. So they doubly redoubled strokes upon the foe. Except they meant to bathe in reeking wounds, or memorize another Golgotha, I cannot tell. But I am faint. My gaseous cry for help.
So well thy words become thee as thy wounds. They smack of honor both. Go, get him surgeons. Who comes here?
The worthy thane of Ross.
What a haste looks through his eyes. So should he look that seems to speak things strange. God save the king.
Whence camest thou, worthy thane?
From Fife, great king. Norway himself, with terrible numbers, assisted by that most disloyal traitor, the thane of Cauldron, began a dismal conflict, till that Bellona's bridegroom, lacked in proof, confronted him with self-comparisons, point against point, rebellious arm against arm, curbing his lavish spirit. And, to conclude, the victory fell on us.
Great happiness! No more that thane of Cawdor shall deceive our bosom interest. Go! Pronounce his present death, and with his former title greet Macbeth.
I'll see it done.
What he hath lost, noble Macbeth hath won.
Where hast thou been, sister?
Killing swine!
Look what I have!
Show me!
Here I have a pilot's thumb, wrecked us home where he did come.
A drum!
Macbeth the pilot! The weird sisters hand in hand, coasters of the sea and land, thus to go about, thrice to thine and thrice to mine, and thrice again to make up nine.
Peace! The charms wound up. So foul and fair a day I have not seen. What are these? So withered and so wild in their attire that look not like the inhabitants of the earth and yet are on it. Live you, for you aught that man may question. You seem to understand me. By each at once, her choppy finger laying upon her skinny lips.
You should be women, and yet your beards forbid me to interpret that you are so.
Speak, if you can. What are you?
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Glamis.
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Cawdor. All hail, Macbeth. Thou shalt be king hereafter.
Good sir, why do you start and seem to fear things that do sound so fair? In the name of truth, are ye fantastical? Or that indeed which outwardly ye show? My noble partner, you greet with present grace and great prediction that he seems wrapped withal. To me you speak not. Speak then to me, who neither beg nor fear your favors nor your hate.
Hail! Hail! Hail!
Lesser than Macbeth and greater!
Not so happy, yet much happier.
Thou shalt get kings, though thou be none, so all hail Macbeth and Banquo.
Banquo and Macbeth, all hail!
Stay, you imperfect speakers! Tell me more. By Sindel's death I know I am Thane of Glamis, but how of Cawdor? The Thane of Cawdor lives, a prosperous gentleman, and to be king? Stands not within the prospect of belief, no more than to be Cawdor. Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence, or why upon this blasted heath you stop our way with such prophetic greeting. Speak, I charge you!
The earth hath bubbles as the water has, and these are of them. Whither are they vanished?
Into the air, and what seemed corporal melted as breath into the wind. Would they had stayed?
Were such things here as we do speak about? Or have we eaten on the instained root that takes the reason prisoner?
Your children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
And Thane of Cawdor too, went it not so?
To the selfsame tune and words. Who's here?
The king hath happily received, Macbeth, the news of thy success, and everyone to bear thy praises in his kingdom's great defense and pour them down before him.
We are sent to give thee from our royal master thanks.
And for an earnest of a greater honor, he bade me from him call thee Thane of Cawdor, in which addition hail, most worthy Thane, for it is thine.
What, can the devil speak true?
If the Thane of Cawdor lives, why do you dress me in borrowed robes?
Who was the Thane lives yet, but under heavy judgment bears that life which he deserves to lose.
Glamis and Thane of Cawdor. Greatest is behind. I thank you, gentlemen. Do you not wish that your children shall be kings, when those that gave the Thane of Cawdor to me promised no less to them?
That trusted home might yet enkindle you into the crown, besides the Thane of Cawdor. But 'tis strange, and oftentimes to win us to our harm, the instruments of darkness tell us truths, win us with honest trifles to betray us in deepest consequence.
Cousins, a word, I pray you.
Two truths are told as happy prologues to the swelling act of the imperial theme. This supernatural soliciting cannot be ill, cannot be good. If ill, why hath given me earnest of success commencing in a truth? I am Thane of Cawdor. If good, why do I yield to that suggestion whose horrid image doth unfix my hair and make my seated heart knock at my ribs against the use of nature? Present fears are less than horrible imaginings. My thought, whose murder yet is but fantastical, shakes so my single state of man that function is smothered in surmise, and nothing is but what is not.
Look how our partner's wrapped.
If chance will have me king, then chance may crown me without my stir.
New honors come upon him, like our strange garments, cleave not to their mold, but with the aid of use.
Come what come may, time and the hour runs through the roughest day.
Worthy Macbeth, we stay upon your leisure.
Oh, give me your favor, my dull brain was wrought with things forgotten. Let us toward the king. Think upon what hath chanced. And at more time, the interim having waited, let us speak our free hearts each to other.
Very gladly.
Till then, enough. Come, friends.
Is execution done on Cawdor?
Please, they are not yet come back. But I have spoke with one that saw him die, who did report that, very frankly, he confessed his treasons. Implore your highness pardon, set forth a deep repentance. Nothing in his life became him like the leaving it. He died as one who had been studied in his death.
He was a gentleman on whom I built an absolute trust. Worthy is cousin! The sin of my ingratitude even now was heavy on me. Thou art so far before that swiftest wing of recompense is slow to overtake thee. Only I have left to say, more is thy due than more than all can pay.
The service and the loyalty I owe in doing it pays itself. Your highness' part is to receive our duties, and our duties are to your throne and state, children and servants, which do but what they should, by doing everything safe toward your love and honor.
Welcome hither. I have begun to plant thee, and will labor to make thee full of growing. Noble Banquo, that has no less deserved, nor should be known no less to have done so heavy. And hold thee to thy heart.
There, if I grow, the harvest is your own.
My plenteous joys, wanton and fullness, seek to hide themselves in drops of sorrow. Sons, kinsmen, thanes, and you whose places are the nearest know, we will establish our estate upon our eldest, Malcolm, whom we name hereafter the Prince of Cumberland, which honor must not unaccompanied invest him only, but signs of nobleness like stars shall shine on all deservers, from hence to Inverness, and bind us further to you.
The rest is labor which is not used for you. I'll be myself the harbinger, and make joyful the hearing of my wife with your approach. So humbly take my leave.
My worthy Cawdor!
The Prince of Cumberland. That is a step on which I must fall down, or else o'erleap, for in my way it lies. Stars, hide your fires, let not light see my black and deep desires.
They met me in the day of success, and I have learned by the perfectest report they have more in them than mortal knowledge. When I burned in desire to question them further, they made themselves air into which they vanished. Whilst I stood rapt in the wonder of it, came missives from the king, who all hailed me Thane of Cawdor, by which title before these weird sisters saluted me, and referred me to the coming on of time, with hail, king, that shalt be. This have I thought good to deliver thee, my dearest partner of greatness, that thou mightst not lose the dues of rejoicing by being ignorant of what greatness is promised thee. Lay it to thy heart, and farewell. Glamis, thou art, and Cawdor, and shall be what thou art promised. Yet do I fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou wouldst be great, art not without ambition, but without the illness should attend it. What thou wouldst highly, that wouldst thou holily. Wouldst not play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Hide thee hither, that I may pour my spirits in thine ear and chastise with the valor of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden round which fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned withal. What is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Thou art mad to say it. Is not thy master with him? Or who were it so would have informed for preparation?
So please you, it is true. Our Thane is coming. One of my fellows have a speed of him.
Give him tending. He brings great news. The raven himself is hoarse, that croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits that tend on mortal thoughts.
unsex me here and fill me from the crown to the toe, top full of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood. Stop up the access and passage to remorse, that no compunctious visitings of nature shake my fell purpose, nor keep peace between the effect and it. Come to my woman's breasts and take my milk for gall. You murdering ministers, wherever in your sightless substances you wait on nature's mischief. Come, thick night, and pall thee in the dunnest smoke of hell, that my keen knife see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peep through the blanket of the dark to cry, hold, hold. Worthy Cawdor, greater than both by the all hail hereafter. Thy letters have transported me beyond this ignorant present, and I feel now the future in the instant.
My dearest love, Duncan comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he purposes.
Oh, never shall sun that morrow see. Your face, my thane, is as a book where men may read strange matters. To beguile the time, look like the time. Bear welcome in your eye, your hand, your tongue. Look like the innocent flower, but be the serpent under it. For he that's coming must be provided for, and you shall put this night's great business into my dispatch, which shall to all our nights and days to come give solely sovereign sway and masterdom.
We will speak further.
Only look up clear. To alter favor ever is to fear. Leave all the rest to me.
This castle hath a pleasant seat.
The air is delicate.
See, our honored hostess. The love that follows us sometimes is our trouble, which still we think is love.
All our service in every point, twice done and then done double, were poor and single business to contend against those honors deep and broad wherewith your majesty loads our house.
Where's the Thane of Cawdor? We coursed him at his heels with purpose to be his purveyor, but he rides well, and his great love, sharp as his spur, hath pulled him to his home before us. Fair and noble hostess, we are your guests tonight.
Your servants ever.
Give me your hand, by your leave, hostess.
If it were done, when 'tis done, then 'twere well it were done quickly. If the assassination could trammel up the consequence and catch with his surcease success, that but this blow might be the be-all and the end-all here. But here, upon this bank and shawl of time, we'd jump the life to come. But in these cases, we still have judgment here, that we but teach bloody instructions, which, being taught, return to plague the inventor. This even-handed justice commends the ingredients of our poisoned chalice to our own lips. He's here in double trust. First, as I am his kinsman and his subject, strong both against the deed, then as his host, who should against his murderer shut the door, not bear the knife myself. Besides, this Duncan hath
borne his faculties so weak, hath been so clear in his great office that his virtues will plead like angels, trumpet-tongued against the deep damnation of his taking off. In pity, like a naked newborn babe striding the blast, or heaven's cherubims horsed upon the sightless couriers of the air, shall blow the horrid deed in every eye, that tears shall drown the wind. I have no spur to prick the sides of my intent, but only vaulting ambition, which o'erleaps itself and falls on the other.
How now, what news?
They have almost supped. Why have you left the chamber?
Hath he asked for me?
No, you not, he has.
We will proceed no further in this business. He hath honored me of late, and I have bought golden opinions from all sorts of people, which would be worn now in their newest gloss, not cast aside so soon.
Was the hope drunk, wherein you dressed yourself? Hath it slept since? And wakes it now to look so green and pale at what it did so freely? From this time, such I account thy love, art thou afeard to be the same in thine own act and valor as thou art in desire? Wouldst thou have that which thou esteemest the ornament of life, and live a coward in thine own esteem, letting I dare not wait upon, I would, like the poor cat in the adage.
Prithee, peace! I dare do all that may become a man. Who dares do more is none.
What beast was then that made you break this enterprise to me? When you durst do it, then you were a man. And to be more than what you were, you would be so much more the man. Nor time nor place did then adhere, and yet you would make both. They have made themselves, and that their fitness now does unmake you. I have given suck, and know how tender 'tis to love the babe that milks me. I would, while it was smiling in my face, have plucked my nipple from his boneless gums, and dashed the brains out, had I so sworn as you have done to this.
If we should fail...
We fail! But screw your courage to the sticking place, and will not fail. When Duncan is asleep, whereto the rather shall his day's hard journey soundly invite him? His two chamberlains will I wine and wassail, so convinced that memory, the warder of the brain, shall be a few, and the receipt of reason a limbeck only. When in swinish sleep their drenched natures lie as in a deck, what cannot you and I perform upon the unguarded Duncan? What not put upon his spongy officers, who shall bear the guilt of our great quell?
Bring forth men children only, for thy undaunted metal should compose nothing but mares. Will it not be received when we have marked with blood those sleepy two of his own chamber, and used their very daggers that they have done?
Who dares receive it other, as we shall make our griefs and clamors roar upon his death?
I am settled. And bend up each corporal agent to this terrible feat. Away, and mock the time with fairest show. False face must hide what false heart doth know.
How goes the night, boy?
The moon is down. I have not heard the clock.
And she goes down at 12.
I take 'tis later, sir.
Hold. Take my sword. There's husbandry in heaven. Their candles are all out. Take thee that, too. A heavy summons lies like lead upon me, and yet I would not sleep. Give my sword. Who's there?
A friend.
What, sir? Not yet at rest? The king's abed. He hath been in unusual pleasure and sent forth great largesse to your offices. This diamond he bids me greet your wife withal by the name of most kind hostess, and shut up in measureless content.
Being unprepared, our will became the servant to defect, which else should free have wrought.
All's well. I dreamed last night of the three weird sisters. To you they have showed some truth.
I think not of them.
Yet when we could entreat an hour to serve, we would spend it with some words upon that business, if you would grant the time.
At your kind's leisure.
If you shall cleave to my consent when 'tis, it shall make honor for you.
So I lose none in seeking to augment it, but keep my bosom franchised and allegiance clear, I shall be counseled.
Good repose the while.
Thanks, sir. The like to you.
Go bid thy mistress, when my drink is ready, she strike upon the bell. Get thee to bed.
Is this a dagger which I see before me? The handle toward my hand.
Come, let me clutch thee. I have thee not, yet I see thee still. Art thou not, fatal vision, sensible to feeling as to sight?
Or art thou but a dagger of the mind? A false creation proceeding from the heat-oppressed brain.
I see thee still, in form as palpable as that which now I draw.
Thou marshalest to me the way I was going, and such an instrument I was to use. Mine eyes are made the fools of the other senses, or else worth all the rest. I see thee yet. And on thy blade and dudgeon, gouts of blood, which was not so before.
There's no such thing. It is the bloody business which informs thus to mine eyes.
Now, o'er the one half world, nature seems dead. And wicked dreams abuse the curtained sleep. Witchcraft celebrates pale Hecate's offerings and withered murder. Alarmed by his sentinel, the wolf, whose howls his watch. Thus, with his stealthy pace, with Tarquin's ravishing strides towards his design, moves like a ghost.
Thou sure and firm set earth, hear not my steps. Which way they walk, for fear thy very stones prate of my whereabout, and take the present horror from the time which now suits with it.
Whilst I threat, he lives. Words to the heat of deeds, too cold breath gives. I go. And it is done. The bell invites me. Hear it not, Duncan, for it is a knell that summons thee to heaven or to hell.
That which hath made them drunk hath made me bold. What hath quenched them hath given me fire. It was the owl that shrieked, the fatal bellman which gives the sternest good night. He is about it. The doors are open, and the surfeited grooms do mock their charge with snores. I have drugged their possets,
that death and nature do contend about them, whether they live or die.
Who's there, what hope?
Alack, I am afeard they have awaked, and 'tis not done. The attempt and not the deed confounds us. Hark! I laid their daggers ready. He could not miss them. Had he not resembled my father as he slept, I had done it. My husband!
I have done the deed. Didst thou not hear a noise?
I heard the owl scream and the cricket's cry. Did not you speak?
When?
Now.
As I descended?
Aye.
Hark, who lies in the second chamber?
Donalbain.
Oh, this is a sorry sight.
Foolish thought to say a sorry sight.
There's one did laugh in sleep, and one cried murder, that they did wake each other. I stood and heard them, but they did say their prayers and address them again to sleep.
There are two lodged together.
One cried, God bless us, and amen the other, as they had seen me with these hangman's hands. Listening their fear, I could not say amen when they did say, God bless us.
Consider it not so deeply.
But wherefore could I not pronounce amen? I had most need of blessing, and amen stuck in my throat.
These deeds must not be thought after these ways, so it will make us mad.
Methought I heard a voice cry, sleep no more. Macbeth does murder sleep. The innocent sleep, sleep that knits up the raveled sleeve of care, the death of each day's life, balm of hurt mind, sore labor's bath, chief nourisher in life's peace.
What do you mean?
Course, still it cried, sleep no more. To all the house, clowns have murdered sleep, and therefore Cauldron shall sleep no more, Macbeth shall sleep no more!
What is it that thus cry? What worthy thing you do unbend your noble strength to think so brain sickly of things? Go get some water and wash this filthy witness from your hand. Why did you bring the daggers from the place? They must lie there. Go carry them! And smear the sleepy grooms with blood.
I'll go no more. I am afraid to think what I have done. Look on again, I dare not.
Infirm of purpose! Give me the daggers. The sleeping and the dead are but as pictures. 'Tis the eye of childhood that fears a painted devil. If he do bleed, I'll gild the faces of the grooms withal, for it must seem their guilt.
Oh, where is that knocking? How is it with me that every noise appalls me? What hands are here? They pluck out mine eyes. Will all great Neptune's ocean wash this blood clean from my hand? No, this my hand will rather the multitudinous seas incarn the dying, making the green one red.
My hands are of your color, but I shame to wear a heart so white. I hear a knocking at the south entry. Retire we to our chamber. A little water clears us of this deed. How easy is it then? Your constancy hath left you unattended. More knocking. Put on your nightgown, lest occasion call us and show us to be watchers. Be not lost so poorly in your thoughts.
To know my deed, 'twere best not know myself. Wait, Duncan, with thy knocking. I would thou couldst.
Oh, yes, a knocking indeed. If a man were porter of hell, he should have old turning the key. Knock, knock! Who's there in the name of Beelzebub? Here's a farmer that hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Calling time. Have napkins enough about you. Here, you'll sweat for it. Knock, knock! Who's there in the other devil's name? Faith, here's an equivocator that could swear in both scales against either scale. Committed treason enough for God's sake. Yet, could not equivocate to heaven. Come in, equivocator. Knock, knock, knock. Who's there? Faith, here's an English tailor that comes hither for stealing out of a French host. Come in, tailor. Here, you may roast your goose. Knock, knock. Never it quiet. But this place is too cold for hell. Oh, devil porter, no further! I would have thought to have let in some of all professions that go the primrose way to the everlasting bonfire! Anon, anon! I pray you remember the porter.
Was it so late, friend, ere you went to bed that you do lie so late?
Faith, sir, we were carousing till the second cock, and drink, sir, is a great provoker of three things.
What three things does drink especially provoke?
Mary, sir. Nose painting, sleep, and urine. Lechery, sir, it provokes and unprovokes. It provokes desire, but takes away from performance. Therefore, much drink may be said to be an equivocator with lechery. It makes him, and it mars him. It sets him on and takes him off. It persuades him and disheartens him. It makes him stand to and not stand to. In conclusion, equivocating him into a sleep and giving him the lie leaves him.
I believe drink gave thee the lie last night.
That it did, sir.
Is thy master stirring? Our knocking has awaked him. Here he comes.
Tomorrow, noble sir.
Tomorrow, both. Is the king stirring, worthy thing?
Not yet.
He did command me to call timely on him. I have almost slipped the hour.
I'll bring you to him.
I'll make some bold call. For 'tis my limited service.
Goes the king hence today?
He does. He did appoint so.
The night has been unruly. Where we lay our chimneys were blown down. And as they say, lamentings heard in the air, strange screams of death, and prophesying with accents terrible of dire combustion and confused events new hatched to the woeful time. The obscure bird clamored the livelong night. Some say the earth was feverous and did shake.
'Twas a rough night.
Oh, horror, horror, horror! Tongue nor heart cannot conceive nor name thee.
What's the matter?
Confusion now hath made his masterpiece. Most sacrilegious murder hath broke ope the Lord's anointed temple. And stole thence the life of the building.
But what is it you say, the life?
Me knew his majesty.
Approach the chamber and destroy your sight. See and then speak yourselves. Awake! Awake! Ring the alarm bell. Murder and treason. Banquo and Ross, Malcolm, awake! Shake off this downy sleep, death's counterfeit, and look on death itself. Up, up, and see the great doom's image. Malcolm, Banquo!
What's the business that such a hideous trumpet calls to parley the sleepers of the house? Speak. Speak.
Gentle lady, 'tis not for you to hear what I can speak. The repetition in a woman's ear would murder as it fell. Oh, Banquo, Banquo! Our royal master's murdered.
Oh, alas, what, in our house?
Too cruel anywhere. Dear Duff, I prithee contradict thyself and say it is not so.
Oh, had I but lived and died an hour before this chance, I had lived a blessed time. For from this instant there's nothing serious in mortality. All is but toys, renown and grace is dead.
What's amiss?
You are, and do not know it. In the spring, the head, the fountain of your blood is stopped. The very source of it is stopped.
Your royal father's murdered.
their pillows. They stared and were distracted. No man's life was to be trusted with them.
Oh, yet I do repent me of my fury, that I did kill them.
Wherefore did you so?
Who can be wise, amazed, tempered, and furious, loyal, and neutral in a moment? No man! The expedition of my violent love outrun the pause of reason. Here lie Duncan, his silver skin laced with his golden blood. His gashed stabs looked like a breach in nature for ruin's wasteful entrance. There, the murderers, steeped in the colors of their trade, their daggers unmannerly breached with gore. Who could refrain that had a heart to love and in that heart courage to make his love known?
Help me, Hedge!
But to the lady!
Why do I hold my tongue that most may claim this argument for mine?
Look to the lady! When we have our naked frailties hid that suffer in exposure, let us meet and question this most bloody piece of work to know it further. Fears and scruples shake us.
Let's briefly put on manly readiness and meet in the hall together.
Well contented.
What will I do? To show an unfelt sorrow is an office which the false man does easy. I'll to England. This murderous shaft that shot hath not yet lighted, and the safest way is to avoid the aim.
How goes the world, sir, now?
Why see you not? Duncan's horses, beauteous and swift, turned wild in nature, broke their stalls, flung out, contending against obedience, as they would make war with mankind.
'Tis said they eat each other.
They did so.
Is known who did this more than bloody deed?
Those that Macbeth hath slain.
Alas, the day.
Malcolm's away and fled, which puts upon him suspicion of the deed.
Against nature still. Thriftless ambition that wilt raven up thine own life's means. Then 'tis most like the sovereignty will fall upon Macbeth.
He is already named and gone to Scone to be invested.
Will you to Scone?
No, cousin, I'll to Fife.
Well, I will thither.
Well, may you see things well done there. Adieu, lest our old robes sit easier than our new.